Oh.
One, two. One, two. Okay, pleasant good morning, everyone. Well, the viewing can take place now. We're going to have the open tribute in a while, right? We are a bit late in opening the casket. But for those of you who want to view the body, you may do so in an orderly fashion. I would recommend if you are close family members like this family here, you all can come together. But if you are alone, you may do so individually. Okay, so for the viewing, if we could have, if you are coming, you come together as a family. But the rest of you, if you're coming individually, you just do that by yourself. So let's do that at this time for those of you who want to see the body. Alright, so one family or one individual at a time, just not to crowd up here. Also keep in mind that the family requests that no pictures be taken of Sharon. So keep your phone in your pockets.
My soul is thirsty.
Okay, present good morning once more. This sermon, although it's not on your program, this segment also is not just for the viewing, but the open tribute segment. And I want to welcome those at this time who want to say something. Those of you who are not family members, right, or directly related to the family, but you will want to say something, because if you notice the program, there are no open tributes in the program. Right? When the program starts, then it just gets going. And the only tributes that are there is the one from New Life Prayer and Family Tributes. So if perchance you are here and you are not family, that you wouldn't come later in the program, but you want to say something, I welcome you at this time, orderly. Praise God.
Pleasant good morning. I just want to take the time out to extend my deepest sympathy to Sharon's family. Mel Sharon has gone way back since she became a member of our church in South Rivers. She was a very close person to me. I was one of the person who had a good relationship with her. She was a person who always be the first to be in our church. And not only to church alone, but she will bring other children to Sunday school. She always been Sunday school. And I can recall before she gets sick that one of the things she said to me, she called me, I was ushering, and she called me and she said, Susan, you know, this year, God is really calling me because I have dreamed something, but I can't remember her dream, what she said. But she said that God is calling her and it is time, and she had made up her mind. And I said to her, you know, you got to do what you're supposed to do. And I can see way back that she began to be faithful and commit herself to God. And I can recall that she sent a voice note to the church chat. And I was on my bed lying. And when I listened, I heard she was like groaning. And I just jump up and I say, oh my God, Sharon is in pain. And I didn't do anything more than I mute my TV, and then I said, you know what, I'm going to send a prayer for her. And I sent two requests for her, one that I was praying for her and the other I was encouraging her. And today I really thank God that I had the opportunity to do that for her, because she was a very good person. She was a person who always on time, and she was a person who, no care where I am in town, sometimes I do not see her, but she will just wave in and say, Sister Susan. And sometimes she will even come and say, you look good. And I will really miss her, because when I go to church and I see her, I will really miss her. Because I can recall one day she was late, and I said to her, Sharon, you're losing mark. And then she said to me, you know what, I had to go home back because I forgot something. I say, okay. And I never one day again forget her. So may her soul rest in peace.
I must say, please and a pleasant good morning to the whole household of faith. Let's all give God thanks and praise, you know, so that we can be and send our way at alive to see each other's face, glory and praise to Jesus' name for his redeeming grace. To the bereaved family, I want to tell you, let Christ be the solid rock on which you stand, for all other ground, they are sinking sand. I met Sharon when I went at the hospital. I am sick also. I'll soon die by God's grace. But still, I'm thankful for the time that he loaned me still, you know. And Sharon all the time encouraged me. She said, Mrs. Nash, don't study your situation. Just pray and, you know, She had kept me going, and you know, God bless her soul. I just want to sing this song for her.
I went to the church where you used to go. The preacher, he was standing, he met me at the door. He said, I know who you are, and I know whom you're looking for. But Sharon, Sharon, don't live here anymore. Sharon, somewhere around the throne of God, Sharon, she is somewhere around the throne of God. I keep searching, yes, I'm searching until I should find her, for she's somewhere around God's throne. Oh yes, I know she is somewhere around the throne of God. Sharon, she is somewhere around the throne of God. Hey, I keep searching, yes, I'm searching until I should find her. Sharon's somewhere around God's throne.
Thank you.
Good morning to everyone. Morning, and I'm sending out my sympathy to the bereaved family and friends. My sister them gave me the courage to come up here and speak because I met Sharon in the hospital. When I went in, I met her in there. She was going to take operation. Myself, I took operation. And I was talking to her and was telling her that have faith. Don't frighten. One day, the Lord is going to call us home. We know that. We are all scared. We are human beings and we are all scared. And she's a very nice person. My sister, they gave me the courage to come up and speak because I've met her in the hospital, as I said, and she was a very, very nice person. And I'm so glad that the daughter called me and told me that her mommy died. And I'm so glad I had the opportunity to come and say that we all must be our brother's keeper. And everybody have a good day. Thank you.
Good day, everyone. I met Sharon many years ago. As a matter of fact, she was my husband's classmate. And when he introduced me to her, he said, you know, Sharon was one of the brightest students in primary school with me. And then she just looked away like she was really shy. And that was years ago when I came to St. Vincent. And then I moved to Diamond. And we realized Sharon was living up in Prospect. And every day, Sharon would see me. She would wave. After she got sick and I knew she what was going on, I used to visit her in the hospital. And I was encouraged by her. You know, you go to the hospital to encourage the sick. And there was Sharon encouraging me. And if you see my phone, every morning and every evening, she would send a little message. Good morning, Nurse Utley. Good evening, Nurse Utley. Even if that's the only thing she said. And, you know, I thought of that. And when she told me, she confided in me and she said, well, this is the situation, but I don't want you to tell anyone. I said, but if I have folks praying for you, I need to tell them what they're praying about. But I was discreet anyhow in disclosing certain things. But even then, Sharon had faith. And what really got me sad is that I think I sent a message to Sharon's phone minutes before she died. Because Sharon had said that she was planning to be baptized. And I kept encouraging her. And that morning, after 4, I woke up and Sharon was on my mind. And I sent a message to Sharon. The message went around after 4. And 10:30 that very morning, a member from my prayer group called and said, I heard Sharon died this morning. We are saddened by her death, but I want to encourage you, her relatives, at least take a page out of her book. She was a very pleasant young lady, you understand? And despite of her circumstances, she didn't just dwell on it, but she was able to encourage others. And sometimes we think and we say to ourselves, how is it that really nice people just come and they just wither away like grass? And miserable people, I mean, all of us know somebody who's not the most pleasant person out there. And they seem to live a very, very long life, you know? And then I said to myself, God is giving each of us an opportunity to make things right. So the persons who are peacemakers, the persons who are just lovely people out there, they may seem to just wither away. But those of us who still have those rough edges to be smoothened, those of us who still need to brush up on certain areas, the Lord is giving us extra time so that we can make things right before it's eternally too late. So let us be encouraged by the life that she lived, and let us pray to God that we become who he wants us to become before we depart from this life. Thank you very much.
Pleasant good morning to everyone. I have known Terika mommy for a good while, and I had known her for a very good while, and they are very nice people. I know Sharika because she was with my brother, and knowing her, she's a very good person too, and I know that the mother is very, very good. And when Sharika had called me and told me that her mom did, I felt a way, yes, because I know she's a good person. And I really feel different and feel a kind of way in my body, because we all have to die. But sometimes the good ones will just leave us very fast. I just want to sing this song because she was a good person. And I sing it because I know she always have a good heart towards people. Love you, Lord, For your mercy never fails me. And all my days, we've been held in your hands. From the moment that we wake up until I hear your voice, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all our life you have been so, so good. But every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I hear your voice, I will sing of the goodness of God. Thank you.
Okay, good morning again. A bit on the protocol side, I have been asked to remind you to sit on the seats that have a white thing at the back, right? So we might have to do a bit of shifting, right? But if you are closely related, you know, but you live in the same home, you know how that is. You can stick together. But other than that, I've been instructed to ask you to just sit on the one that has the white thing at the back. Okay? Right? Just to keep the protocols in place during the time that we are living in. Okay, so just a little shifting, and that's all. Nothing big. We are still having the open tributes. Those of you who just came in, you want to say something? Please come.
Good morning, church. No hearing. And my mouth big. Yeah, my mouth big. Good morning. Morning, church. I'm one of Sharon's many cousins, and I just want to say that Sharon was really a joker in the family. Very jovial and very warm-hearted. You know, when any one of our family were ill and of that sort, Sharon would find us wherever we are. She would leave way in the country where she's living, and she would find us wherever we are in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, and she would be so concerned and would be praying for us and cheering us on. And when she see evening is coming, she would say, you know, I have to go catch van to go back in the country. I could recall when my father passed away, I don't know where Sharon got all those people, but it's a bus full of people she brought with her from the country to come and pay respect. And, you know, we would miss her. She was very jokey with her broad smile and her teary eyes. We would all miss her. And I just want to encourage Sherika. She's somewhere about, and I haven't seen the other two, but Amanda and the rest of the family, let us stay close. But my main concern is for us, those of you who don't know the Lord as Savior, one day we are not here forever. We are just passing through. And we all would have to give an account for the life we live here on earth. And we know for a fact, John 3:16 says that God sent his only Son, that none of us should perish, but all of us have a chance at eternal life. Today, this time, now we have life, is the time for us to make use of that chance of eternal life. Because one day, we would be lying, same place where Sharon is now, we would be lying there one day. If the trumpet doesn't come and we doesn't go with the Lord, we would all be in the same position one day. Somebody would come and pay their tribute the same way. I just want to encourage someone, make the best use of the life God gave us and do it by serving him in spirit and in truth.
to the immediate family, stay close to each other. Love one another, irregardless of the situation life entails you with. Live close to God and love each other from the depths of your heart. May God bless you.
A pleasant, blessed good morning to each and every one, and we truly want to give God a high note of praise and thanksgiving for being alive and well and on the land of the living. And this morning I want to say, on behalf of, well, I don't see much people from Kingston Hill or Tong Hill here this morning, but I want to let you all know that Sharon and I and all of us reared up together from a young and tender age, and she was such a lovely person. And when I heard that she passed away, I said to myself, I said, what is life to all of us? Today we are here, and tomorrow we are gone. Today, this moment that we are here in church, and the next minute we are gone. But I want to say that Sharon and I had a love. When they talk about playing marbles and all different games, Sharon was that kind of person. And when I heard of she passing, I said this morning, with the help of God, once he lend me the breath, I'm going to be here this morning. So I'm here this morning to encourage the family. As Paul says in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 30, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. So I encourage any family members this morning, all those who are here, to continue to trust in God, because we do not know the next minute, we do not know the next hour. So I'm encouraging all of us to stand up for Jesus. And those who are here and do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, as the sister says and other says, behold, the Bible says, now is the day of salvation. Behold, now is the acceptable time. If you shall hear his voice, harden not your heart. You look around and you see how people are going, it is for us to take heed of warning. Careless soul, take heed of warning. May God come to bless you. And all the family members, stay closer to one another. Pray for one another. If there is ever a time that we need to, as family members, need to draw closer to one another and pray for one another, it is in times like these. God bless you.
I too want to express my condolences to the family of Sharon. I'm saddened also by her death. I mean, I'm her cousin-in-law. When she came to Salt Rivers, I met her. And from then, we became friends, not that close friends, but she was a part of our church, New Life Prayer Tabernacle, and then our relationship grew from there. And knowing Sharon, she was indeed a very polite, friendly person. I mean, she just know how to make friends. Even if she don't know you much, she will still come and try to talk and socialize with her. So from back then, we have developed this relationship. And even at the time when she was sick or started to feel that sick, I mean, we started to get even closer. I mean, it was very much impossible for me to be here, but I really, 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 really wanted to be here. Even last night, myself and the daughter was talking, but thank God that I'm here to pay my last respect to her. And I really trust that this time will be a time of reflection for all of us. I mean, the Bible says that life is a season. There's a time to born, there's a time to die. And even as the other speakers have said, death is inevitable. We all will die if Christ does not come soon. So I want to encourage us, let not this sadness just be a part of the now, but let us all take into consideration that our life will come to an end, but there is hope after death, and that hope can only be found in Christ Jesus. I am also happy that Sharon had given her heart over to the Lord. Yes, she did not get the opportunity to be baptized, But the Bible says that once we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved. So be blessed and be encouraged, even as in all that is taking place, even by the preach word, even if we have to surrender our hearts to the Lord today, after the message is being preached, let's do so, so that you're able to see Sharon one day again. So bless the Lord.
A blessed good morning to everyone. I do not really know the deceased that well. I got to know her when she was on her sick bed. I got to speak to her via video chat because Sherika is a colleague of mine and a good friend. I met Sherika 2 years ago, and she's a very nice person. And from speaking to the mother, I get to see where she got that from. Well, I just want to let the family know that that is not the end. And she was in pain, and God saw that and called her home. So on behalf of the St. Vincent Community College, the nursing division, myself, and Batch 43, we would like to tell the family to hold on to God's unchanging hand. He knows best. I want to sing a little verse of a song. In the dark of the midnight, do I often hid my face when the storm howls above me and there's no hiding place? In the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry, keep me safe till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over and the thunder sounds no more, and the clouds roll forever from the skies. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. The storm will soon pass. Thank you. Good morning, church. I just want to sing this song on behalf of the family and my co-worker, Amanda John. I didn't know today would be our last, that I have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb, I can't feel anymore. Praying you just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels
around the throne tonight. Always makes my troubles feel so small. And you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight.
Praise the Lord. Praise God. Praise the Lord. And we are going to close the casket. So if you have not viewed Sharon, we came in late. We gave you 1 minute to get that done. Praise God. I try not to crowd it. Praise the Lord. Say a pleasant good morning once more to all of you, family, friends, relatives, loved ones, acquaintances, all of you who are here and even those who are viewing. Otherwise, we welcome you to Free Temple. Let me ask you to stand with me as we begin the service. We have had the open tribute, and now we are going to continue with other aspects of the service. Psalms 23, some of you know it. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restored my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Here is the scripture reading. Father God, we come before you this morning. We thank you, God, for life. Thank you, God, that we can be here in the land of the living, God, to give you praise. Father, oh God, to congregate together as we pay our respects, God, to our dear sister. God, we ask that you may lead us and guide us as we enter this service today. We ask for the guidance and direction of the Holy Spirit. Life are in this place, God, and I pray that God will minister unto each and every one of us. I pray, God, that all that will be said and done will bring glory and honor unto your name. And even as, God, we are in the Easter weekend celebrating the death and soon the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, God, help us to be mindful, Father, that you are the one who sent your Son to die for us. And may our hearts be filled with worship. May our hearts be filled with gratitude, O God. And those who are far off, may they be drawn near to you today. We commit this service, God, everything, into your hands, and we put you before us. We say, have your way, God. Take control in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Praise the Lord. And this time we want to welcome our worship team to lead us into a time of praise and worship. Praise God.
Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is worthy of praise and honor. God commended his love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So we can praise God because he has won the victory for us, and we are definitely happy. Those of us who have accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we are happy that one day we will meet him, as Sharon has already met him. Praise be to the Lord. Hallelujah.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. I worship your
I worship.
hold on in the midst of the struggles and the trials. Hold on. Will your anchor hold in the storms of life? When the clouds unfold their wings of strife, when the strong tides flip and the cables break, will your anchor drift off from remain? We have an anchor that keeps the storm steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Fastened to the rock, which cannot move, rocking forward in the ship, we are with your anchor pulls in the storms of life. When the clouds unfold their wings of strife, when the strong tide lifts and the gale of strength, will your anchor drift off of remain? We have an anchor that keeps the storm steadfast and sure while the billows roll. Passion to the rock, which cannot move, rocking from
this rock is Jesus.
there is always hope. There is always hope in the midst of the trial and the circumstances. God holds us. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Praise the Lord. You may have your seats. Praise God. Praise the Lord. And we know that. And we can tell you from our side, Sharon would have enjoyed this singing. She would have enjoyed that worship. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. At this time, we want to have our first scripture reading from Shani John. All right, our first scripture reading from Shani. Is she here? First scripture reading, Shani John. Praise the Lord. Praise God.
Then shall the king said unto them on his right hand, come you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was an hunger, and you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. And I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you come unto me. Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee, and hunger, and fed thee, are thirsty and gave thee drink? When saw we thee a stranger and took thee in, or naked and clothed thee? And when saw we thee sick or in prison and came upon thee? And the king shall answer and said unto them, verily I said unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, whatever, ye have done it unto me.
Thanks to the Lord. Praise the Lord. Why, thank you. At this time we have a hymn, so I guess I'm inviting the worship leader, because he lives, all right, so come and let's have this hymn, because healing. And next up, we'll have the tribute from New Line Prayer. So we ask that person to get ready also.
Thank you.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Praise God. Praise God. And at this time, we want to have a tribute from New Life Prayer Tabernacle. So let me ask Mr. Beverly. Oh, and Brother Jamal is coming too, so please go.
Pleasant good morning all. Tribute on behalf of the New Life Prayer Tabernacle, South Rivers. There was one person who was always early. Whatever the occasion was, that person was Sharon. Sharon would be the one person who seems to be ahead of everyone. In church, in Christian Ed, better known as Sunday School, she would be the first student to present. And there were times when she would have gone by pastor's home and asked, "We now get church today, now?" When the doors of the church were not open, most times she sat in the back of the church. Pastor would be the one to invite her in the discussion or strategically call her for her involvement. Though Sharon was not being an official member of the church, she was definitely in regular attendance. Most Sundays, as long as she is in South Rivers, Sharon would be in church. Pastor described her as a kind soul. I'm sure the members would agree. She often responded to altar calls for prayer and was involved in our worship session. Many times, she expressed desire to be baptized. And last year, she was among the converts to be baptized. But unfortunately, it did not take place. Based on her confession, her desire to live for the Lord, we have high hopes that she is with the Lord, but only God knows. Sharon will be dearly missed in our services, and we just want to take the time to express our deepest condolences to her family, friends, and loved ones. The New Life Prayer Tabernacle, headed by Pastor Donnelly Duncan, along with his family, is praying for you. And may God strengthen you during this time. Also, I would like to say, Sharon was a very close friend to my son, Akim, because all of them used to go Converse class together. He was 8 at the time. And then Sharon would say, "Miss Bailey, you don't have to come over there for Akim. Me go bring him home. And then Akim would say, "But mommy, she a treat me like if me a one baby. Yeah, hold me and bring me over and then tell me go home." So, he really, really wanted us to be a part of the funeral service, but you know, because of the COVID and whatever, he has to be home. So may her soul rest in peace. God bless all the family.
Blessing. Just want to sing this song to the bereaved family. God will bless you all today.
You are my strength. Strength like no other, strength like no other, reaches to me. You are my strength, you are my strength, oh, strength. My hope, oh, like no other. fell in love, stronger than mountains, deeper than ocean, reaches me unfailing.
Done by Rohan Robinson, and they're calling to come and give a second scripture reading. Please come.
Morning to everyone. Scripture reading this morning is taken from 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50 to 58. Now I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither thou corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet of the song shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and the mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and the mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass, saying, that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is in the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as ye know the Lord, know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord.
Thanks be to God. This time we want to have the family tributes, and then giving them an order of how they must go. We have the audio. We have an audio first. I can't recognize the first name, but we have an audio first. The family will know what I'm referring to. Please. An audio, and then the saxophone. Yes? Let's go. Has the audio been sent? If not, maybe just have the saxophone, the tribute, who's going to do the saxophone, and then we will take the audio after. If we don't have the saxophone, then we push forward again. I see a next audio, but I'm guessing at the same situation. Let's do the dance then. Not sure if it's there. So let's have the dance. And of course, it's family tribute. So after she's finished dancing, the family members, if you want to come over and say something, you can do that. It's not the eulogy, but it's family tribute. So after she's finished, your family member, and we want to come and say something, we need that as well.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Before I begin my tributing song in sign language, I would like to just give us a word of encouragement. Words seem so feeble. In moments like these, life is so precious, and death is such a thief. The depths of our pain only God can comprehend. Grief he experienced, pain, sadness, sorrow, he understands. So let's give our pain to the greatest comforter of all time, and he'll help us through this battle. It's not ours, the grief, this emptiness, this sorrow. This battle is definitely not ours. It belongs to God. So bear with me as I do this tribute in a song, in sign language, the battle.
Oh,
family members, you want to say something? It is time for the family tributes. So, in the right ahead.
Morning, everyone. Well, first and foremost, I want to thank everybody for attending, and on behalf of myself and my sisters and those who could not make it, I know that we would all be strong for each other. Who is Sharon? Sharon, a mother of three and to many more. I know Sharon for, well, I'm her aunt, and I must say, before the round the tongue, in no disrespect to anybody, nor to the family, before the round the tongue taxi came around, we could say that Sharon was the round the tongue taxi. Because I don't think that there is a place in town that Sharon did not know. Punctuality was one of her main things. As many of her church friends would say, she was always there. Her grandmother, which was my mother, now deceased, she used to have to come to Kingstown every month. And because she was suffering from glaucoma, we were somewhat afraid of her walking around. And we would say to her, "Mommy, who is coming to meet you?" "Sharon is." And that boat leaves Beckway at 6:30. And you can bet it, before 7:30, Sharon is there to meet Mommy, take her to the doctor or wherever she has to go. And then she would be sure that Mommy get back on the boat for 1 o'clock. If Sharon say that she's going to do something for you, you know that she's going to do it. We have relatives in the States who are unable to attend but are viewing. When they're here, Sharon would make it her business that they have their fruits every morning. And I know that many can attest to it, that Sharon would be missed, and I know loving was her. And it's a pity that in life we do not take the time to tell our family and friends and loved ones how much we love and appreciate them. We always wait until it's too late. The dead cannot hear us. They cannot speak. So while we are yet alive, let us take the time out to tell our family and friends that we love them, we care for them, and we appreciate what they do. The Morgan family tree, as I see, Noretta has now posted on her phone. It's a big family tree, and it's a pity that only death can bring family together. Let us not wait until loved ones are gone to get to know each other. While we are yet alive, let us embrace each other. And as the nurse said when she came up, it is one thing that used to wake me up in mornings is that 5 o'clock. I would know when it's 5 o'clock because my phone would go off and I would say, "Sharon." She would call or she would text, "Tanti, good morning, God loves you." I would do it just the same and we would exchange good night to each other. Everybody know that Sharon loved to walk. And while speaking to her daughter after she passed, she said to me, "Tanti, you know, Mommy love died what she loves doing best." And I started laughing. And she said, "No, Tanti, don't laugh. You know Mommy died walking. It may sound strange to y'all. How can somebody die walking?" But as she got up that morning, she asked to be taken out to her seat. And while going to her seat, that's when she collapsed. So on behalf of everyone again, I just want to say thank you and a pleasant day.
Yes, I want to say good morning to everyone. On behalf of the South Rivers community, we Miss Sharon a lot. Sharon was nice and friendly, and Sharon was a kind lady. She came into South Rivers to live with my family, the Lewis family, Houston, and we find no fault with Sharon. Sharon will greatly missing by the children, especially Sunday school. At Sunday time, she take a lot of people to church. And Sharon gives she life, but she, God is good. And Sharon going to meet the Savior, I know that. Sharon, my soul, rest in peace.
Good morning, everyone. I am going to say something about my granny. My granny was very loving. My granny was loving, kind, and helpful. She was always there for everyone. If someone was in the hospital, she would have a bath, put on her clothes, and pack her bag and go to the hospital. She used to come to my school every day. She used to bring a snack and give me water. Now she is dead, and we can't do anything about it. People have to die sometimes. I will miss my granny.
Bless the Lord. As the word of God says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. I am really surprised, in spite of this situation, so many people take the opportunity to come out. And that can just tell us about the life of Sharon. I am one of the oldest aunt on Sharon's side. And as I heard many people said, you know, every morning Sharon will call, message at least, and say, good morning, Auntie Gloria. And I will reply back to her in that same way. I even remember the same day that she died, I did not get a call from her. So I said, the morning, my mind just, you know, just reflecting on her. And when I get up, I search the phone. I said, no, this ain't look like it's natural. And when I call, I did not get an answer. I call back again, and Sherika answered the phone. And there's where I heard that she have passed from hence to eternity. And I just want to sing a song, or a verse of one song. Bless the Lord. I know my life on earth is ending, and only she who feels the pain. She was not afraid to face the devil. She won a stranger to the rain. Gush out on the mountain, Sharon, your life on earth is past. Go to heaven and shouting words of the fire
thunder and the sun. Oh, how we cried the day you left us. We gathered round the grave to weep. Oh, how we see their angels' faces as they hear your sweet voice sing. Go shout on the mountain, Sharon, your life an altar spouse. Go to heaven and shout it, words of the Father and the Son. Go to heaven and shout it, words of the Father and the Son.
I would not say may, but I will say, will your soul rest in peace. God bless the family.
Hello, this is from Sharon, great aunt. I miss you very much. You are a loving person, but I thank God he takes you from suffering, and may he always keep you in his tender, loving care, Janet John.
Our beloved Sharon, cousin, mother to Sharika, Rohan, Shanique, grandmother to Shamaya, sister Loretta, Amanda, brother Ransford, niece to Gloria, Patrice, Linda, Donna, Jacinta, Diana, Rosalie, Denley, and Lawrence. Friend to Machu and many others. It was truly devastating to lose you so soon. You will be truly missed. You were such a kind soul. Your time here on earth is done. God has finally called you home to a place of rest, where there is no more pain, no more sorrow, no more suffering. You are safely resting in the arms of Jesus. All of us who are still here moans for your departure, but we thank God that he is our comforter. He promised he will never leave us, neither forsake us. So we look on to the author and finisher of our faith to grant us the peace that passeth all understanding. So sleep on, my cousin. Sleep on until we meet on the other side. Go take your rest in the bosom of Jesus. This is your loving cousin, one of your many loving cousins, Grace. In Jesus' name.
So we move forward. Those were the family tributes. And that is it, right? Just in case I don't miss anymore. Okay. For this time, we want to have another hymn, The Old Rugged Cross. So let me call on our worship leader one more time to lead us into this hymn.
Dearest and best, for a world of
rugged cross, stained with blood, so divine, how wondrous beauty we see.
Hallelujah.
Thoughts were spun, that old cross, Jesus suffered and time to pardon and sanctify me. So we run, so I'll cherish the old rugged cross. One day, share my trophies and
sins are nailed, your sins are there. Praise God, praise God. And at this time, we are going to have the eulogy. Right? We're going to invite Loretta John, sister of Sharon, to do the eulogy.
Good afternoon, everyone. Firstly, let me say thanks to those of you who are here and viewing online for taking this time out to pay your last respect to Sharon, my sister, and to support the family at this time. Also, I would like to thank those who called, visited, texted, and prayed. Your actions did not go unnoticed, but reinforced the fact that at the end of the day, we need each other. Today, 3rd April 2021, makes 7 years and 362 days since I stood in the same church to deliver my father's eulogy. The late Armand Michael, Never would I imagine in less than a decade I would have been back here to eulogize my sister. When Sharika, her eldest daughter, asked me to do a eulogy, elegy, as Sharon would say, no matter how we tried to correct her, she never got it right. I wondered what to say. A lot of things went through my mind, but nothing flowed. However, I remembered the words I said to her other children, Rohan and Shanique, on the day she died. I told them Sharon would live on in their memories and encourage them to emulate her good qualities. With that, some thoughts came to mind. Yesterday, I called her siblings, children, and a few of her friends to hear what they had to say about her, and they echoed my thoughts. In the 49 years, 3 months, and 24 days, God allowed Sharon to be a member of a family, of our family, I have seen a very generous and helpful woman. She gave up her time and whatever she had. She took pleasure in running errands for others. Sharon spent about 10 years in South Rivers after starting a relationship with Matthew Lewis. However, she was always at Prospect, where two of her children reside. Tanti Patrice related that once she asked Sharon why she had to leave South River so early in the morning, she responded, "She does things for people." And I think we all knew that she also wanted to be around her children. Sharon was not one to say no when you ask her to do something for you. Even if it was last minute, she always found a way. Shanique, her youngest daughter, recalled even if they just finished arguing and she asked her to do something, she would do it. The only time we heard Sharon said no was last year when Sharika asked her to do something for Shamaya, her granddaughter. She indicated she was not able to do it. That day, Sharika cried. She said, "Nereta, something is wrong with mommy. She never said no. She never said no when I asked her to do something for Shamaya." As I mentioned before, Sharon gave up whatever she had. When plums and ackee or whatever fruits were in, she would call and say she have some for us. She would find out if we were coming into town. If our plans were not in line with her timing, she would find out where she can leave it, or sometimes she would bring it for us. She would find other times she would call and say she have something to give us, to give to her. She have something that someone give to her and she asks if we want it. Sharon always has something to share. This quality her friends and family can attest to. Sharon was very reliable and was always on time. I remember when Granny, the late Edna John, would come to the mainland from Bekwe, Sharon would get to the wharf and wait patiently for Granny. She got that from Mommy, the late Louise John. They were always early. Whenever we had to go somewhere with her or to meet her, we tried to be on time because we didn't want to hear her calling every minute to ask us if we leave home or where we did so long. Growing up, Sharon's mouth would sometimes get her in trouble because it was not lazy, as old people would say. A vice I think she learned to control with time. Nevertheless, she was mannerly and respectful. I can't remember her ever quarreling with me. If she disagreed with me, she would only listen and say, "Okay." Even though I was younger than her, she would respond to me by saying, "Yes, please. No, please, thank you, good morning, and good night." I know my siblings and family members, especially those abroad, would say the same. She was of a quiet disposition, Nothing seems to bother her, but she loved life and she loved action. Shanique, her daughter, said she was quick to forgive and would often say, to err is human, to forgive is divine. She was jovial. Her expressions made you laugh and make you feel at ease around her. I remember the Saturday before she passed. She told me, tell me friend, me put on weight. And she laughed. In a way, she had a childlike quality in that she was eager to receive anything you promised her. If you say, Sharon, I have something for you, make sure you give her one time or the other day, or she would be constantly reminding you that you promised her something. Also, she liked to sit at the back of the vans by the window. You know, she liked to ride in Freddy and Jicky. I'm not sure why, but I think she did so that she can shout and wave to everyone she knows like a school child. Sharon liked to be in town, and she would often be seen with her daughter. You know, sometimes we would call them goat and rope. Growing up, we told her she liked her own way, and she always had a story explaining why she did not reach back on time. Sharon liked walking so much that I don't think it was coincidence she died while walking. Old people say, so you live, so you die, right? Sharon also loved family. She had the opportunity to know 5 generations, from our great-grandmother to a great-nephew. She enjoyed talking about her childhood days in Fobb's Yard and at Tunghill. She boasts that Mama, our deceased great-grandmother, Annie Morgan, never beat her and would always leave some food for her. Sharon also loved her belly. She also had fond memories of a man by the name of Pahel. When we moved to Behill, Sharon was always up to something, but she made the time fun. I think my best memory of with her at Behill was an occasion when school was closed and we were home alone. She came up with this grand idea to give Mommy a surprise when she gets home from work. She had a plan which we agreed to. The plan involved painting the inside of the front door to the living room. We found some green paint. Mind you, the inside of the house was beige, but Sharon convinced us that the color change would be a good idea. The other part of the plan involved pressing my brother's hair. When Sharon was finished, she did not like the look, the way it looked, so she decided to cut the hair. Ransford was called Apache for a while. I need not mention, Mommy was indeed surprised, but not pleasantly so. However, I noticed they never changed the color of the door. Sharon lived in Beckwith for a short time and was able to bond with the family who lived there. She was that family member who kept the family in the know, or I would say updated. She would call to inform us which family member was sick, who was in the hospital, and what she had to take for them, you know, and who was coming home and when they were going back. Besides, she kept up to date with persons who were visiting from either Canada or America and arranged to get little sweets, you know, little treats that my cousins liked to send up for them. Sharon loved my cousins abroad, especially Zita, Biebs, Gracie, and Debbie, and our great aunt, Tante Junita. They were there to her. I don't know if it's because she grew up with them. Likewise, they loved her dearly. To them, she was Shishi. Moreover, she remembered everyone's birthday, locally and abroad, and she would send a birthday greeting on 705 radio. She would call to say, today's Zita's birthday. Then she would call back to say she's going to send a greeting. It would be followed by another call to tell us that the greeting was going to come over just now, and another call after to ask if we heard it. Sharika and I would normally anticipate the call. Sharon would message every morning and every evening to say good morning and good night. Upon her death, it made me even more aware of the number of persons Sharon would message every morning. I don't know. She was probably happy with the advent of the cell phone and WhatsApp, because I don't know where she would have gotten all that money to keep in touch with everyone. Sharon worked as a gang leader on the government's road project. She was not ashamed of what she did, and she took pride in her work. She got excited around that time. I remember last year she was in the hospital. We were telling her she would miss out this year since she would not be sufficiently recovered from her surgery. She was there thinking of the person who to call to work and all of that. To our surprise, one day Sharon called to say she was going to work. However, we must not worry, because she would take a chair to sit down. She got along well with all the members on the gang and with Buster Potts at the end of the job. I told you before, she loved to eat. She was supportive and would assist you where possible. As a result, she would present herself at every sporting event for any family member and any function, you know, that her niece and nephews were participating. Her granddaughter Shamaya was the love of her life. She would regularly send messages to tell her she loved her and would call. She would go out to her school almost daily to take snacks for her. She was always the one in the family to make sure the graveside of our dead family members would be kept clean and everything. Sharon specialized in the small things that impacted us in a big way. More importantly, she loved the Lord. When we were growing up, Mommy made sure we went to Sunday school and church. However, I think Sharon got excited about church when she met a lady by the name of Sarah Archibald. If my memory serves me correct, their church was located in Union House, Middle Street. Everything for Sharon was Sarah. When Sharon likes you, she likes you. Nevertheless, she did not surrender her life totally to God. However, she was always conscious of God. Last year, she called to say she accepted the Lord and was going to start Converse classes and will be getting baptized in August. We planned to be there to witness her big day. Unfortunately, for more reason than one, she did not get to do so. Nevertheless, I am convinced she made her path right with God, which is important. During her ailment, I saw a woman who trusted God and was strong. She was always saying, God is good, don't worry. She was jovial. She's still looking forward, you know, to see what she can do for others, how she can help, what she can send. She also prayed, sang, and made declaration. She had a good spirit. Sharon did not complain. If she was in pain or worried, she did not show it to us. Had it not been for the weight loss, I would not have known something was wrong. I remember that Thursday before she died. She was singing a song, God Will Take Care of You. It was a song a friend sent to me via WhatsApp, by a voice note, and I shared with her. I noticed on that night, she inserted the words, God will take care of me. That night, she sang the song twice. The next day, Friday, she sang the song, and I noticed there was an adjustment to the song. She simply sang, God will take care of you. I was tempted to ask why she did not make the changes like before. However, I said nothing. On Saturday, time did not permit us to sing the song. However, today, I believe God is taking care of Sharon, and I'm encouraging the children, other relatives, and friends to allow God to take care of you. I realize Sharon might not have been rich in terms of money and educational achievement, but she was rich in love and in God. As I told her children, she would live on in their memories, and they can carry on her legacy by emulating her good qualities, by being lovable, being polite, helpful, family-oriented, humble, and surrendered to Christ. As I reflected, I saw a lot of Mommy in Sharon. So for me today, it's like burying my mother for a second time.
However, I know that God will continue to take care of me. And I'm saying to the others, He indeed can take care of you. I would just like to dedicate this song that Sharon takes so much pleasure in her last days, that was sent to me by my friend Tracy Poole. So to her children and the rest of her family and her dear friends, this song is for you. Thank you.
Good morning, church. Sorry. Good afternoon, church. My deepest condolences to the Johns family. I pray the lyrics of this song conveys my heart's message for the family, close friends, and loved ones. Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. Beneath His wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God, yes, He will take care of you through every
yes, he will. For sure, he will take care of us. As his word says, we must cast all our cares and burdens upon him, for he careth for us. Praise the Lord. Praise God. At this time, we want to hear from the Word of God. If you do have the Bibles, we want to read from Psalms chapter 90. Psalms chapter 90, we are going to focus on verse 12, but I want to read from verse 1. And I'm reading to you from the ESV version. It says, Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You return man to dust and say, return, O children of man, for 1,000 years in your sight are but as yesterday when it is past, or as a watch in the night. You sweep them away as with a flood. They are like a dream, like grass that is renewed in the morning. In the morning, it flourishes and is renewed. In the evening, it fades and withers. For we are brought to an end by your anger. By your wrath, we are dismayed. You have set our iniquities before you, our sins in the light of your presence. For all our days pass away under your wrath. We bring our years to an end like a sigh. The years of our life are 70, or even by reason of strength, 80. Yet their span is but toil and trouble. They are soon gone, and we fly away. Who considers the power of your anger and your wrath according to the fear of you? So teach us to number our days, that we may get a heart of wisdom. Father God, we thank you for your word this afternoon. Thank you, God, for all those who are here. We are still in the land of the living, God. And your word says that let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. And so, Father, we praise you this afternoon, this wonderful Easter weekend. God, we give you praise. We give you glory and honor. And Jesus, you are still on the throne. You have defeated all enemies. Every foe has been defeated. And we thank you for victory. God, as I'm about to declare your word today, I pray, God, for the hearers, that you would give them ears to hear, hearts to receive, God, eyes to see. And I pray that, God, your word will reach far in the depths of their souls. God, we pray that there will be a response to your word. They will not just be hearers, but doers of your word. And as your man servant, God, I also pray for the anointing, God, the unction, the ability. Father, I pray that by your Holy Spirit, you will, oh God, engulf me even now, and let the words, oh God, that I speak be filled with the power of the Spirit of God. Father, take control. Let your kingdom come Let your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. This afternoon, for a brief moment, I want to speak to you on the topic, teach us to number our days. Teach us to number our days. Death comes to us with very little warning. Even though we may know the day, or the week, or the month, or the year, we still don't know the exact time we will leave this earth. There are times when persons will go to the hospital in a state of emergency. You know, you think that, boy, this looks serious. And when you get the news and the messages and you say, you're thinking if they are going to make it. Then the person comes out a week later and they say, well, everything is okay, you know. It's just so and so, and they live on. And then there are times when it's not really a state of emergency. A person might say, let me just go and take a checkup. Because you never know. Let me just take a checkup. Might have had headaches or belly pain, and let me just go and check to see if everything is okay. Within a week, that person, from a simple checkup, they are gone. Death comes to us with little warning. That we don't know when it's going to come exactly. Even though the doctors will say, well, based on calculations, you have 3 or so weeks, or maybe a month or two. Still, we don't know the exact time that we are going to leave this earth. And as it's Easter weekend, we are looking back and looking forward. We are celebrating the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's a good time for you, my friends, to consider your life. It's a good time to consider your ways. Verse 12 tells us, teach us to number our days, that we may get a heart of wisdom. The time that we are living in now, with the pandemic, but even more serious, for us locally, we have a number of threats. We have a volcano. The sleeping giant is still asleep, but the snoring is getting louder. There are some who this fact has been gone from their mind that they forget there's a volcano. Somebody said the other day, we forget that today. But the scientists keep warning us and reminding us, hey, be prepared. Hey, put things in order. Hey, I hope that you get somebody to go through and you have an evacuation plan. The news keep coming out, telling us how big it's getting by the day, by the week. And the scientists keep echoing. Listen, the last time he said, if you want a warning, well, this is your warning. And so we have that threat. We still have, maybe on a lesser scale, the threat of the dengue fever that has sadly taken some of our children and even adults too. And we have threats on every side. Then we have that big one, the pandemic. This COVID-19 that has entered our world as we know. How we knew life should be. COVID-19 has just entered and disrupted everything from since last year. And we are still trying to get a grip of this enemy, this
sickness, this virus, is affecting churches. It's affecting the economy. It's affecting homes and families. But with all that threat, all those things that are threat to us as a nation, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, there are some who need to really pray this prayer. Lord, teach us to number our days. There are some who are still blinded to the fact that today you could be here and tomorrow you could be gone. There are still some who are still sleeping. Who are still snoring. Even though the signs are there, you don't have to be one who has physical sight to know that these are dangerous times. Signs are everywhere. And so, the call from the psalmist today is that, Lord, teach us to number our days. Jeremiah 17 and verse 9, the prophet said, the heart is deceitful above all things, and desperately wicked. Who can understand it? Man's heart continue to show its true colors in these last days. The awareness of God and the response to the call of God seems to be going unheeded. Based on all that has been happening in our country, people should be running to God. People should be running towards God. But instead, we are having a repeat of what took place in the book of Genesis. We are having a repeat of what took place in the time of Noah. Genesis chapter 6, verse 1 tells us that when man began to multiply on the face of the land, and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of man were attractive, and they took as their wives any they chose. Then the Lord said, my spirit shall not abide in man forever, for he is a flesh. His day shall be 120 years. Verse 5 tells us, the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, I will blot out man whom I have created from the face of the land, man and animals, creeping things, and birds of the heavens, for I am sorry that I have made them. And verse 8 tells us, but Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. So it was in the days of Noah, so it is today. There are persons who, instead of running to God in these dangerous times, they can't wait for things to open back up to go and party. They can't wait for things to open back up. You see, we have to have carnival this year. We missed last year. We can't miss this year. Instead of saying, Lord, teach us to number our days and take life more seriously and take your soul more seriously, there are those who couldn't care less. They're not taking stock of their lives. So many warnings are being given. But as it was in the days of Noah, so it is these days. Young and old could care less what the church say, could care less what the Bible say. They will live their life however they please. But today I want to say to you who are here, and it's a prayer that I hope you will pray, that you will ask God to help you to number your days and teach you how to. Because one day, the day will come. The time will come. The moment will come. When you will be in a casket, it might not look like this one, but nevertheless, it will be a casket, and it will go 6 feet under. By that time, whatever decision you have made, it's done, gone. You can't make another decision after that. And so, I say to you today, who are here, that I pray that you will take stock of your life, that you will turn to God before it's too late. Genesis chapter 7 tells us, on the very same day, Noah and his sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and Noah's wife, and the three wives of his son with them, entered the ark. In the days of Noah, only Noah and his wife, that's two, his three sons, that's five, and their wives entered the ark. So what happened to the rest of the people? What happened to those who saw Noah building the ark? What happened to them? Well, Matthew 24, verse 38 to 39 gives us a picture. For in those days, before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day when Noah entered the ark. And they were unaware until the flood came and swept them all away. So will be the coming of the Son of Man. They were unaware until the flood came. Imagine the screaming, the hollering of the people who were there when they realized what Noah was preaching, because the Bible says he was a preacher of righteousness. What he was preaching was the truth, but the ark was closed because the Bible tells us that God shut them in. It was too late. They couldn't call out to Noah, because even if Noah wanted to help them, he can't help them. They were shut in. So it was in the days of Noah, so it is today, that many today, they're having a nice time, living out your life. But a time will come when the ark will be closed and will be shut in, safe and sound, and then the rains will start coming up. Oh, then you weeping and gnashing of teeth. Some of you, you grew up in church. Some of you live next to a church. Some of you are here because we preach every year. Every year there's a crusade in your community, and every year you're there. But you have never repented and turned from your sin. Listen to me, that some of you are here today, that you will fall in hell because you have not repented of your sins. You're going to cry. You're going to bawl. You will holler. Because you remember the times that you were given an opportunity. You remember the times that the preacher given out a call. Or a sister come to you and say, come here, go to church. Or your mother encouraged you to serve God. Or your sibling, somebody. You remember those opportunities, but it will be too late. But the Bible says, so will the coming of the Son of Man be. The reality of death, as we are talking about, teach us to number our days. Let me ask you this. Do you know how many years you were given? Do you know how many years you have left? Here's what happened back in Noah again. The flood continued 40 days on the earth. The waters increased and bore up the ark, and it rose high above the earth. The waters prevailed and increased greatly on the earth, and the ark floated on the face of the waters. The waters prevailed so mightily on the earth that all the high mountains under the whole heaven were covered. The waters prevailed again above the mountains, covering them 15 cubits deep. And all flesh died that move on the earth. Birds, livestock, beasts, all swarming creatures that swarm on the earth, and all mankind. Everything on the dry land in whose nostrils was the breath of life died. He blotted out every living thing that was on the face of the ground. Man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens, they were blotted off from the earth. Only Noah was left and those who were with him in the ark. My friend today, how long will you neglect the call of God on your life? Backsliders, when are you going to come home? You've been gone so long. When are you coming home? When will you stop running from God? You talk about the church and who hurt you in the church and who did this and who did that so many years ago. The person not there and gone, but you still, this person did this to me, and the pastor didn't do this, and when I went to church, the usher didn't greet me properly, and all kind of things you are mentioning, but is it worth it? When you think of your soul, when you think of how precious is your soul, is it worth it? So young man, young lady, sir, miss, madam, do you know how many days you have left? Do you know how many days you have? Well, it really doesn't matter, because we'll try to figure out. We can't know. Only God knows that. But what you must know is Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and verse 14 tells us, for God will bring every deed into judgment, with every secret thing, whether good or evil. God will bring everything into judgment. I know at times in our own country, some wicked people, sometimes we say they get away because they do their stuff and they go to jail, and we say they get fat or whatever. And what they did, they seem like they paid for the crime. But there come a day. Oh, there come a day. With every wicked person, vengeance is the Lord. That God will take vengeance upon every sinner upon the face of the earth. God will take vengeance. You think you are afraid of the devil, or you should be afraid of the devil? You don't know the God that we are talking about. God is the one whom you should be afraid of. He's the one whom you should be trembling for. Because he's the one who will cast your soul into hell. He could send dread upon you, and he is going to send dread upon this world. The Bible tells us that the tribulation time, a time where, listen, a time like never seen before. That's what the Bible says. There was never a time like it. If you think what we are facing now, this pandemic, is anything, my friend, you don't want to stick around when the tribulation starts, because that is when you will see trouble. There's some rumors going around and say somebody started this COVID thing, and whoever started. But whoever started it, listen, when God begins to pour the wrath, you will know who do it. The time will come when he will pour out his wrath upon them. The earth is just as when it was in the time of Noah. When there was much screaming, when there was much crying, because the ark was closed. All the signs are there. The ark, will be closed soon. The rain will start coming soon, says Vincent and the Grenadines. The rain will start coming soon. So I said to you, get in the ark before it's too late. Get in the ark. No matter what people say, no matter what your friends might think about you, at the end of the day, you want to make your soul secure. You want to book your passport. You want to book your flight and make sure that you are on the way to heaven.